Well, good morning and welcome. If you can't be with us on Facebook Live on a Sunday morning at 9 o'clock on our church website, Christian Life Camps Bay, these are just taped messages just so you can keep up with us. And basically, in our services, we've been looking at Paul's first letter to Timothy, where Paul, the old apostle, writes to his spiritual son and encourages him in terms of his ministry in Ephesus, in terms of how to do church better. And so we've called the series Getting Better Together. And we've looked at a whole lot of things, and we're in chapter 6 now. And this morning we're going to be looking at verses 11 to 21, really the last section of the letter. And he ends his letter by encouraging Timothy to lead by example and to finish his life on earth with faith. And so that's kind of the theme that we're looking at today, finishing in the faith. And if you look at verse 10 of 1 Timothy chapter 6, he talks about those who, because of their love of money, wandered away from the faith. Some who love money have wandered away from the faith. And Paul is saying, instead of wandering away from the faith, finish in the faith. And I want to finish my life on earth in faith. I don't want to be one who wanders away. And this is a hugely important matter for us. I tend to be someone who believes once saved, always saved. But if I permanently wander away from the faith, then I was never actually saved. And in 1 John, the first letter of John, chapter 2, verse 19, the apostle writes about those who had permanently wandered away from the faith. And he says, they went out from us, but they were not of us. If they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that it might become plain that they are all not of us. And so if we wander away and we don't continue in the faith, then we never really had genuine saving faith. Continuity in the faith is a mark of a genuine faith. Paul writes about this in Colossians where he says, you who were once alienated, he is now reconciled by his death, if indeed you continue in the faith. Continuity is a mark of genuine saving faith. And so Paul writes these amazing verses here in chapter 6, verses 11 to 21, where he looks at how to express our faith and finish strong and continue until our lives end. And I want to look at some of the lessons in terms of how to finish in the faith. But first, let's just read the passage together. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 11, he says, but as for you, O man of God, instead of wandering away from the faith, flee these things. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pilate made the good confession, to keep the commandment unstained and free from reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will display at the proper time. And then Paul just worships God. And next Sunday we're going to look at these two verses in terms of how we need to focus our worship on the Lord. So we're going to kind of dwell on this a little bit more, but we're just going to look at it briefly this morning, where he speaks of God, he who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. Then he says, as for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty, nor to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly provides us with everything to enjoy. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, thus storing up treasure for themselves as a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is truly life. O Timothy, guard the deposit entrusted to you. Avoid irreverent babble and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. And by professing it, some have swerved from the faith. Grace be with you. And that word you is in the plural. So it could be grace be with you all. And then we see that this letter wasn't just for Timothy, it was meant for Timothy and the church. He ends in the plural because he intended Timothy to read this to the church so that they could help him and together get better, do church better? So there's a couple of things. We're going to go quite fast. First of all, if we are to finish in the faith, we need to flee from material sins. He says, but as for you, O man of God, flee these things. And the word flee has in it the idea of running away. We need to run away from things that are going to cause us to fall away. And what are these things? He says, flee these things. Well, he's talking about the things that he's been speaking of in verses 3 to 10. And I'll give you a quick summary. They are the things of materialism. Imagining, says verse 5, that godliness is a means of financial gain. So we want to flee from this wrong idea that through religion, through church, through preaching, we can get rich. The idea that godliness brings financial gain, and the desire to be rich is the next part of it. He says they fall into a temptation and a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. So we're not going to be materialistic. We're not going to have a desire to get rich. We're going to avoid the love of money, which is a root of all kinds of evil. And I was looking at all of this last week, and if you missed it, go to the website and you can check out that sermon. And these are the sins which characterize our materialistic age. The lie of capitalism and advertising is this constant promotion of greediness. And Paul is saying, you know what, if you want to finish your life in the faith, we simply need to flee these things. Run for your spiritual life. Get away from the greedy grasp of the message of more and more things and money. Only a fool will stick around and dabble with this ruining temptation to greediness. Maybe we can't just literally run away and live in isolation off the grid, but in our minds and in our attitudes and in our lifestyles and in our choices and what we're modeling for our children, we can flee from a materialistic obsession. Secondly, he says we need to pursue basically holiness of life. He sums it up as pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness. All of this can be summed up as the pursuit of a holy way of life. That word pursue in Greek contains the idea of running swiftly to catch something. And people love to tease runners when they see them running. They say, what are you running from? And often we say, no, we're running for something, whether it's to lose weight or to enjoy creation or to train for a race, whatever it is. We're not just running from something, but in this case, Paul is saying, yes, you need to run from something. Run from sin and run for holiness. Paul describes this whole thing of running. He says in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, I do not run aimlessly. He sees the Christian life like a race, like a runner training for a competition. And he says, I discipline my body and keep it under control. So there's a kind of focus, a pursuit of holiness in the way he runs his life. This focused running and disciplining must include the pursuit of these things: righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness. Pursue the holy life. Flee materialistic greed. Thirdly, keep God's word to the end. He puts a huge emphasis on the need to keep hold of the message of the word of God. He says, fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pilate made the good confession, to keep the commandment. You see, keep the word of God. Keep the commandment of God, the scripture. Keep it unstained and free from reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will display at the proper time. So the believer hears the call of God through the word of God. He makes the confession of faith in that word, as Jesus did before Pilate, and as Timothy had made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. And he's saying, until the return of Jesus, until his appearing out of a cloudy sky, or until you die, whichever comes first, you just keep holding on to that commandment. Keep it unstained. Keep it free until the Lord returns or until you die. In fact, in his second letter, Paul writes to Timothy about how he is expecting to die. He says, my time of departure has come. And then he says, he will be rewarded, as will all who love his appearing. And so his death links with the appearing. When you die, you kind of enter into the final events, which include the second coming of Jesus. And in verse 13 and 14 of chapter 6 in 1 Timothy, we see very clearly that a significant part of this fight involves keeping the word of God. As I mentioned a moment ago, it says, I charge you to keep the commandment, the message, the word that he'd been given must be kept. Further on at the end of the passage in verse 20 and 21, he says, oh, Timothy, guard the deposit entrusted to you. What is that deposit? Well, in 2 Timothy chapter 1, he says it's the pattern of sound words that you've heard from me. And there he says, guard the deposit entrusted to you, the good deposit. So this good deposit that he mentions in both these letters is this pattern of sound words that Timothy heard from Paul. In other words, the teachings of Paul, which became the letters of Paul, which became the New Testament, 13 of the New Testament documents, and the other apostolic community wrote the four Gospels, the other letters, the book of Revelation, which are added to the Old Testament scriptures. And these are the things that must be kept. In this age, we are seeing so many people drifting from the Word of God, either saying we need to reinterpret it to fit culture, or we need to disagree with it and choose culture. And Paul is saying, no, God, keep the Word of God. That is how we finish in the faith. We don't want to drift away into some other faith. And this is a solemn charge that he gets in the presence of God. And then fourthly, if we are to finish in the faith, we need to make sure that we're worshiping the blessed and only sovereign. And in verses 15 and 16, he has this amazing doxology. To him who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone has immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, to whom no one has ever seen or can see, to him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. What a statement. What a worship statement about God. And we need to make sure that he is at the center, that we focus on him, that we give him all the honor, that we give him the high regard and appreciation that only he deserves. And so we're going to look at that next week. Seven amazing truths about God at the heart of worship. So we're going to leave that for a moment. Let's go on now. In terms of finishing in the faith, we need to invest in the eternal future. And we looked at this a little bit last week when we were dealing with verses 17 to 19. You can check out last week's teaching and see that. And he's basically saying that if we use wealth in this godly way, we are investing in eternity. He says we're storing up treasure for the future. How do you do that? Well, number one, you don't kind of think you're great just because you're rich. Don't be haughty if you're rich. Don't put your hope in wealth. Rather, enjoy what God has provided. You see, you can enjoy it. It's a gift. He says God richly provides us with everything to enjoy. So we don't think we're better. We don't put our hope in money. We enjoy what God has given us. And we're also rich in good works and in generous sharing. And in this way, we are storing up treasure for the future. And of course, we also make sure that as well as having wealth, we have eternal life. We take hold of that which is truly life. And so as we put our focus on the eternal life, on the spiritual realities, and as we use money investing in kingdom ministry, in kingdom work, and in sharing generously with those in need, we are, as it were, investing in the eternal future. And then finally, if we're going to finish in the faith, we need to receive God's grace. He ends off with these final words, grace be with you. And as I said at the beginning, the word you is in the plural. It's with you all, with every person in the church, with every believer. Grace be with you all. And this isn't Paul just saying, you know what, I'm signing out now, over and out, here endeth the epistle. No, what he's really saying is this is how to do it. We make the effort and God gives the energy. He gives the grace, and it is by the grace of God that we will finish in the faith. Hallelujah. Grace be with you will enable you in the good fight of faith. In fact, in his second letter to Timothy, in chapter 2, verse 1, he says, you then, my child, be strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus. What an amazing thing. You see, when the grace of God comes to be with you, he strengthens you. In fact, the Spirit of God we're told in Hebrews 10:30, is the Spirit of grace. And so when He comes to be with you and to strengthen you, you will be able to flee and pursue and hold the faith and invest in eternity and worship God with all your heart. And that's what we need to do. We need to invite Him. Come, Spirit of grace. Come and strengthen your people. And I just pray in Jesus' name, wherever they may be, that you would come, Spirit of grace, and strengthen. May you, Holy Spirit of grace, come and be with us, especially in these trying times. We pray that this virus will die under the enthroned feet of Jesus, and that you will give to medical science the ability to care and the insight to cure. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. May God be with you. Next week we're going to look at that amazing doxology as we see how we need to end focusing our worship on God. Amen. God bless you.